Pakistan, that we have to make a conscious effort that all the depressed and deprived classes in the society, including minorities and other sections of the society who historically did not get a fair treatment, they have to be uplifted. Their conditions are to be uplifted and brought at par with everybody else in the state. So this is the constitutional commitment, although it sometimes involves a reverse discrimination. But reverse discrimination is recognized throughout the world to make an affirmative action, to take an affirmative action so as to bring the depressed sections of the society, the underprivileged sections of the society, at par with the others who are not that less privileged. Even our jurisprudence, as far as laws and their judgments and interpretations, the judicial verdicts are concerned, you will find that for the last about 50 years, the courts have been trying to go an extra mile to take care of the areas where women were deprived of their normal rights. In the matter of inheritance, they were generally ignored and not given their due. But the Supreme Court of Pakistan particularly took the initiative and declared that even if somebody was deprived of inheritance hundreds of years ago, if she can still establish her right today, the period of limitation will not be considered and she will be given her right, and so that justice prevails. Then in the matter of transactions, in the matter of alienation of property, the Supreme Court and the judiciary in general has been very careful that if the rights of some Pardanishin lady were involved, then the courts will take extra care to make sure that she had proper legal advice before her name was used for alienation of property. So even there, the rights of women, there was an extra care being taken by the judicial system to ensure that they are not deprived of their legal due. Then, in the criminal side, even the sentencing policy, the sentencing guidelines, which were judicially introduced by the Lahore High Court, and I was the author of that judgment, we took care of women convicts and provided that as far as women are concerned and the children are concerned, if they're they indulge in such an activity and they're convicted, their sentences will be one-third less than the sentences of male convicts, male persons who were convicted. So in every way, we are trying to look after the weaker section of the society so that it is no longer weaker. As far as bails are concerned, even the statute itself provides that concession for female accused persons, and section 497 has a proviso that even in the most heinous of cases, women can be extended the benefit of bail if the court so deems appropriate, whereas this concession is not available to an able-bodied man. Although for men and women, there is another category if they are sick or they're infirm. But being a woman itself gives an indication to the court that some concession may be awarded, may be extended in the matter of bail to a woman, irrespective of the nature of the crime allegedly committed by her. It will be information for you, something new for you, if I tell you that most of these concessions given by the courts in the country to women, and most of the efforts made to reinterpret the law to extend legal rights to the women, were those judgments were authored by judges who only had daughters. This I'm sure you don't know. Most of you don't know. Mr. Justice Muhammad Afzal Zullah, he was blessed with daughters only. And he was the one who gave this breakthrough to women as far as inheritance rights are concerned. Then Justice Naseem Hassan Shah, Chief Justice of Pakistan, he had only three daughters. One of them is my wife. And he also went an extra mile to ensure that women in the country are not deprived of their rights. And all his interpretations in matters relating to women were always perceived and known to be tilting in favor of women. And then Zullah Sahib was the Chief Justice of his time. Dr. Naseem Hassan Shah was the Chief Justice of my time, when I was practicing an advocate. And now I am in that position. And everybody in the legal profession would know that I also have the same tilt, because I have just two daughters. So there is a strange connection moving, and maybe somebody can undertake a study worldwide that who are those judges who gave these, who broke away from the traditions and took an extra step to interpret the law in a way that women's rights are secured. So this is a piece of information which I wanted to share with you. Now, coming to this conference, it's a wonderful exercise undertaken every year. It's the third conference, and the credit for this not only goes to the High Court in general, but to Justice Aisha Malik in particular. And I told you that she's my student, and I'm very proud of her. Her husband is also a very good friend of mine, runs a law college, and I used to teach in that law college with him. In this conference, today's session, we have been lectured, I would say, that this language needs to be changed. Yes, it does need to be changed. Things have moved on in the world. Female gender is very much becoming a part of normal life. It was confined to four walls. For many years, it is coming out of it. And it is becoming, this gender is becoming a regular part of almost every walk of life. And we are very fortunate that even in this third world country of ours, we are making effort and we're taking strides in that direction. And now, previously we had never heard of even women judges in the district judiciary. Now we have as many as almost 300 women judges in the district judiciary. And in the High Court now we have female judges. And inshallah, soon we shall have a judge or two women judges in the Supreme Court. And this issue, I had an opportunity to propose the names of two judges in the Supreme Court, and I can only reveal to you that while selecting names, some female candidates were being actively considered. So maybe it will materialize next time. But one thing that I have noticed as far as women judges are concerned, because they work in an environment which is dominated by men, we have been told in the courtrooms, in the whole system, there are men everywhere and just a few women. Women judges were expected to be very compassionate, very kind, very considerate, like mothers. But we have noticed that when they become judges, somehow, because the whole atmosphere is male dominated, and we were told the term she judge and he judge. So that she judge also likes to behave like a he judge so that she is taken seriously. This is one thing which we have noticed, that she does not even smile in the courtroom lest anybody else may get some impressions. Male judges don't have that problem. They would cut jokes with the lawyers, they would relax the atmosphere, and they'll be comfortable with everybody else appearing in the court. But a female judge, somehow, she has to change her personality. She has to become an iron lady, and so that nobody messes with her. So this is something which I wanted to discuss with you. Just relax. Don't become he judges. You are she judges because you are better in many things. You are compassionate. You are compassionate, you are kind, you are considerate. And when any litigant would see you in the court, he himself or herself, they would feel that they can be in safe hands, very kind hands. But if you start behaving like a bigger he judge than the he judge, and you don't like lawyers to even smile at you, they don't want you to make a very comfortable conversation with you in the courtroom, unless the atmosphere is relaxed, even the lawyers cannot come out of their best. The atmosphere has to be very relaxed in a courtroom so that the litigant feels comfortable and the lawyers also can come up with whatever they want to say in support of their clients. But if the judge is stern, I've seen women judges who have a very stern look. So please relax. People will respect you, people will be very, very considerate towards you just because you are women judges. You don't have to impose yourself upon everybody and try to put on a show and be to represent yourself as something which you are not. So be women in the courtroom as well. Be relaxed and be yourself. Don't put on a show. That is one thing which I wanted to say to you, because this is not just in the courts, this is in the offices as well. And not to talk of Europe or America or other countries where things are much more relaxed now, and this is not something new, but in any third world country when this kind of a step is taken, there's a lot of reaction. Should I tell you that we received 3 applications that some people wanted their cases to be changed from the courts of women judges. Why? Because the judge is a woman. That's it. They are just not comfortable. They can't see a lady sitting there as a judge. So the taboos, the social taboos take over. So it'll take some time, but things are moving on and people are getting relaxed. And once they deal with you, and I'm sure this distinction between women judges and men judges will disappear. So I also had an objection to the word women judges conference. You are judges. So this is a contradiction in terms. We were told that we have to change the vocabulary. So you haven't. Please walk the talk. Act on what you tell us. And then Honorable Mrs. Justice Aisha Malik, kindly next time, Honorable Justice Malik, Aisha Malik, that's it. No women judges. You could coin some other phrase for it, but not a distinction based on gender. You can, I'm sure, with brilliant minds available, you can coin a different term for this kind of a forum. Now that you are judges, you also have to shed this image of yourself as a woman judge. Just behave like judges, normal judges, and dispense justice according to law. And then people themselves will stop noticing that whether they are appearing before a woman judge or a male judge. being a woman obviously brings with it the attributes of a woman. She's kind. She is very, very compassionate. But at the same time, sometimes you have to be firm in the court. Don't allow anybody to browbeat you. Don't allow anybody to undermine your authority. Be courteous, but be firm. Now you'll say that I'm contradicting myself. I'm not. I'm not saying that just change yourself and relax. But at the same time, firmness is something different. You should be very, very, your posture has to be very courteous and decent with everybody. People will start respecting you for your conduct in the court. But at the same time, if somebody, some unscrupulous person, you know, says one word or two words or one sentence, just fix him there and then, so that nobody else even thinks of doing this in another court. And be firm, but at the same time be courteous. And I understand, I can appreciate that you know what I'm talking about. The whole court atmosphere is in your hands. You are in control, so you manage yourself. But don't be extra harsh to prove yourself as a he judge. This is what I've noticed, that female judges, when cases come to us, even in criminal cases, female judges are passing higher sentences. Says I maut. Taki ek impression bada ji badi sakht hai. Kisi ko nahi chhodte. Nahi, impressions, you don't have to create impressions. Your conduct will create impressions. You be absolutely fair, be firm, be courteous, and just move on, relax. Don't try to prove something in a court of law that you are not a woman judge, you are a judge. By your conduct, your decisions, everything will be settled. People will come to know. So this harshness in the attitude, the stern demeanor, this is what I'm hinting at. We have noticed that in order to survive in a man's world, so-called man's world, the women judges have to go take some extra steps, become stern, become tough, so that they are taken seriously. You will be taken seriously through your conduct in the courtroom, how you handle a case, what kind of decisions you give. That should be the yardstick that you should be aiming at, that I'm considered a good judge. I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Gender-based violence courts have been mentioned. I remember I was in St. Petersburg a few months ago, and some European judges and chief justices were taking pride in the fact. Somebody said, we have one gender-based violence courts in our country. Somebody said, we have two. I kept quiet for a while, and then when I was asked to speak, I very humbly told them that we are going to set up 116 gender-based violence courts in every district of the country. They were just taken aback. They were taken aback. I said that there are 116 districts in the country, and we are setting up 116 gender-based violence courts in the country. Not that there's too much violence here. Violence is there, everywhere. But because people don't have resources to approach a court of law on such a subject. So we have to go to them. So in every district, and we're so grateful to Asian Development Bank and Iram Hassan, who also is my student in the law college, they have imparted training, they have given, spent money on this, and we have trained judges on gender-based violence. And somebody was telling me ke agar aapke gunah bakhshe gaye aur aapke agar jannat mein jane ka faisla hua to in adalaton ki wajah se hoga. Sir, ki aapne ye initiative liya जो उन बेचारी कमजोर खवातीन की किसी एक की भी दुआ लग गई तो आपका बेड़ा पार हो जाएगा. थैंक यू वेरी मच. देन आई जस्ट वॉन्टेड टू से समथिंग विच इज जनरल इन नेचर, अप्लाइज टू ऑल जजेस. आई एम वेरी फॉर्चुनेट दैट अबाउट 300 जजेस आर सिटिंग हियर, irrespective of the gender. The verses of the Holy Quran which were read out at the start of today's ceremony, when translated, they meant ki jab tum insano mein faisla karo, logon mein faisla karo, to insaaf se faisla karo aur amanat walon ki amanatein lauta do. Ye hum aksar hamare judicial functions pe इन्हीं आयात की तिलावत की जाती है. सो एज बिफोर बिकमिंग अ जज आई थॉट गॉड ऑलमाइटी वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट टू डिफरेंट थिंग्स, कि जब फैसला करो तो इंसाफ से करो, देन अमानतें अमानत वालों को लौटा दो. दीज आर टू डिफरेंट थिंग्स. व्हेन आई बिकेम अ जज आई सडनली रियलाइज दैट मे बी कुरान हैज मैनी मीनिंग्स, मैनी इंटरप्रिटेशंस पॉसिबल. So maybe God Almighty is talking about the same thing here. कि आप जज हैं, आपके सामने केस लगे हैं, एक कॉज लिस्ट लगी हुई है कि ये केसेस आज सुने जाएंगे, कि जब इंसानों में फैसला करो तो इंसाफ से करो और ये अमानत वालों की अमानतें लौटा दो. कि this is the cause list, these are the trusts that you have to discharge today. These are the things trusted to you today, and this trust is to be discharged today. So this cause list is connected with justice. You are a judge, you are to dispense justice. There are many people sitting in the same courtroom, but they are not judges. There is only one person sitting in the courtroom who can decide the case, and that is you. And if you don't decide the case that day, there's absolutely no difference between you and anybody else in that courtroom. So at the end of every day, you have to take account of the fact, how many amanats did you return? How many trusts that you discharged, which was an obligation on you? Not only that you have to do justice, but also it's a part of doing justice that you have to dispense justice, you have to deliver justice. You may be a just judge. You decide one case in a month and you are very just. Yes, very good of you. But at the same time, there are many, many people clamoring for justice, and it is you and you alone who can decide their cases, and you just ignore your responsibility in that regard and adjourn cases casually. No. Amanat walon ki amanatein, ye list hai jo aaj amanatein lautani hai. Do your best that you exhaust your cause list of the day. You decide as many cases as possible on that given day, because that is the trust that you have to discharge. That is a part of justice that you had to dispense on that particular given day. This is one aspect. The other aspect, which I have also talked to the lawyers in the Saraiki belt in the south of Punjab, that I, in this whirlwind tour of mine, I would also repeat that here, because these are good things, things which God Almighty Himself or Herself has said to us. Herself, is tarah main aapko bataun, there was a priest who died for some time and then he came back to life. So other priests got together and said, "Father, did you die?" He said, "Yes." "Did you go to heaven?" He says, "Yes." And said, "Did you see God?" He said, "Yes." "So can you describe God to us?" That father said, kept quiet for a while, and then said, "Brothers, she is black." You don't get it. "Okay, describe God to us." And he said, "She is black." So there are notions Even God has to be he, and God has to be white. ये notions है ना, तो यही notions हमारे society में भी है. We work in an environment with preconditioned, preconceived notions. We have to dispel those notions. So I was saying that the last thing that I, which I shared with the lawyers in South Punjab, God Almighty says that I love those who dispense justice. There are 7 different kinds of people who have been mentioned in the Holy Quran that God loves those persons. Now just imagine, God could have said, I like those people. They are good people, they are doing their job properly and I appreciate it. No. Inna Allaha yuhibbul muqsitin, ki Allah insaf karne walon ke saath muhabbat karta hai. These are very strong words. The creator of this universe, the creator of everything, all powerful, he falls in love with you. Do you need anything else in life then? He'll take care of you. He'll take care of your health, he'll take care of your prosperity, he'll take care of your family, he'll take care of everything in your life, because he has created you and he has control over you, and control not just over you but over the entire universe. And he is assuring you that if you are just, if you are fair, if you do justice, then Allah falls in love with you. And that's it. Then you don't have to worry about anything. He'll take care of you. So this is the message that I wanted to give, that it's a very, very small price to pay for such a big reward. You just be just in the court. Be just in the court. Give a justice here. Whatever is right, give the due to the person who is entitled to it. And it's not a big deal. Every day you decide cases, you know what is right and what is wrong. The experience tells you within the first 5 minutes what is right and what is wrong. The rest is just procedure, the formalities, the writing of a judgment. But your mind, your heart immediately tells you. Even those who are not judges, even they can judge what is just and what is not. So because we are a part of the system of dispensing justice, so we have to go through the mill, we have to go through the procedure, but the end result is that the decision has to be just and fair and correct. And that's our job, we are trained to do that. And the only thing that God Almighty is requiring here is, ki aap insaf kare. Inna Allaha yuhibbul muqsitin, ki Allah मोहब्बत करता है इंसाफ करने वालों से. इतना सस्ता सौदा आपको मिल रहा है. आप अल्लाह आपके साथ सिर्फ आपको अच्छा नहीं समझेगा, आपसे मोहब्बत करने लग जाए. फॉर अ बिलवड यू कैन डू एनीथिंग. सो गॉड ऑलमाइटी विद ऑल हिज पावर्स और हर पावर्स एंड ऑल द पावर्स अवेलेबल टू द डिवाइन द सुप्रीम द अल्टीमेट अथॉरिटी. So this is one last message that I wanted to share with you, which I have shared with the lawyers in the south of Punjab. And in the end, I would say thank you very much for inviting me here. It's a great honor and privilege for me. And I hope that next time I'll also be invited as a retired judge. And I would like to be a part of this enterprise. And my daughter is also a barrister, so she will be associated, and as a retired judge I would also be a part of the whole exercise, inshallah. Thank you very much.
Chief Justice Asif Saeed Khosa, Lahore mein 30 khawateen judges